Yeah, this is very important. How much ml you can withdraw safely? More important question before that is that never withdraw CS. Try to withdraw CSF if there's raised intracranial pressure. This is raised intracranial. Intracranial pressure is contraindication to the lumbar puncture. Why? Because if pressure in the CS, if intracranial pressure is high, maybe there's a big tumor or swelling. And as soon as from this area, you pull the CSF out, brain will herniate, right through foramen magnum. Medulla will come down and maybe the lower part or tonsillar part of the cerebellum, and that all that gets crushed and patient dies. Is that right? And how you know that patient has really raised intracranial pressure before doing the lumbar puncture? Because it is not written on the patient here that I have a raised intracranial pressure, don't do lumbar puncture. Yeah? Usually we withdraw CSF about 5 to 10 ml per bottle, and usually we take about 3 bottles. Is that right? Yeah. But it should be better to keep it low. Yes, please. Who will tell me that? How do you really know patient has raised intracranial pressure or not before you do the lumbar puncture? Or you ask the patient, do you have? And do you think patient is going to tell you? Yes. Anyone has good idea that how do you know that there's raised intracranial pressure? There's a very dangerous black star with 5 points. Number one, patient has a history of headache. And this headache is usually present already when patient wake up. Any headache which is present already when you wake up, however mild it is, it should be considered serious. Is there any unexplained headache, right? When a person has already, as soon as he wake up, he realizes he has headache, unexplained. But if you have been hit by someone yesterday night, of course, there is well explained headache, right? So any unexplained headache, right, that raises suspicion of the raised intracranial pressure. Because in lying down for a long time, right, fluid accumulates there, and if there is raised intracranial pressure, that becomes further raised, and that produces headache, number one. Number two is, there is, yes, papilledema. You know what is papilledema? Okay, let me tell you. If you do ophthalmoscopy, you know ophthalmoscopy?
Yes.
Right? With the ophthalmoscope, you look through the pupil on the retina. Is that right? Normally, if you look at the retina, it looks like this. What is this? Optic? Disc. This is the point where optic nerve is attached with the eyeball or in the retina. Am I clear? Optic disc. Now, normally the margins of optic disc are very sharp and clear. If there is papilledema, this is called papilla. If it is edematous, then they are no more clear. They look like this. The margins are blurred due to edema. And in raised intracranial pressure, there is papilledema. Raised intracranial pressure may be due to severe meningitis, inflammation of meninges, or due to encephalitis, inflammation of the brain, or raised intracranial pressure may be due to tumors, or raised intracranial pressure may be due to hemorrhages, or any space occupying leonine cranial cavity may lead to high intracranial pressure. And all these situations, lumbar puncture is contraindicated. Is that right? Someone can explain why the patient develop papilledema due to when they have raised intracranial pressure? Do you really want to know the answer, or we move forward? That why raised intracranial pressure produces papilledema? You want to know it? Okay, then I have to draw a diagram. This thing may not be very relevant with this lecture, but it is extremely relevant with your career, that every doctor should know that what are the important signs and symptoms related with raised intracranial pressure, right? Now, papilledema, why it develops? Let me tell you. Okay, this is I make central nervous system. This is central nervous system. And what is this fluid around here? if this is subarachnoid space, what is this fluid? CSF. Is that right? And whenever there is some tumor in the brain, or there is swelling of the brain, or there's inflammation of the meninges, under all these things, cranial cavity cannot expand. So pressure in the cranial cavity goes up. So intracranial pressure is high. Now, listen carefully. What is this? This is dura. This is dura mater. I've not drawn the subarachnoid and pia for simplicity. This is the dura mater. Now listen carefully. Actually, here is your eyeball. This is your eyeball. Okay, let me make it a little bit beautiful. Here should be lens and suspensory ligament. This is your eyeball. Is that right? Now, actually, from here, these are the neuronal, this is the retina. And from here, what is this going out? Optic nerve. And optic nerve is, of course, connected with the central nervous system. Is that right? This is optic nerve going to the chiasma. That we'll discuss later. These are the fibers of optic nerve. Am I clear? No problem in this diagram? Actually, now this is the beauty of understanding. Dura mater moves, makes a sleeve around the optic nerve. If dura mater is making a sleeve around the optic nerve, then it means CSF is also going around the optic nerve up to this point. Am I right? I hope you will never forget this diagram in your life until you are going to deal with the patients, that CSF is around the optic nerve. Why? Because optic nerve is covered by the pia mater. And then it has subarachnoid matter. And optic nerve has an outer covering as dura mater. And there's the special news. Optic nerve is not a nerve. It is a central nervous system tract. We wrongly call it nerve. Is that right? Optic nerve is not typical peripheral nerve. It is actually central nervous system tract. Proof is that it is covered by all the layers of central nervous system. Plus, its myelin sheath of the optic nerve is not made by Schwann cell. Schwann cells are the myelinating cells of peripheral nervous system. Optic nerve has myelinating cells of central nervous system. And central nervous system tracts are myelinated by oligodendrocyte. Optic nerve is also myelinated by oligodendrocyte. Peripheral nerves are myelinated by Schwann cells. Optic nerve is myelinated by oligodendrocyte. Central nervous system tracts are myelinated by oligodendrocyte. So diseases of oligodendrocyte will make disease in the central tract and also in optic nerve. And diseases of Schwann cell will make peripheral nerve diseases, but not optic nerve. Now you understand the whole story. Now another thing. Here is retinal artery going. You must be knowing that retinal artery is a branch of ophthalmic artery. You know it already, I suppose. Now, retinal artery going to the retina. But when it is going to retina, it passes through what area? Pierces the dura mater of the optic nerve, passes through subarachnoid space, retinal artery passes through CSF, then pia mater and into what is this? Optic nerve, and then it supplies the retinal branches to the retina. Am I clear? Of course. Then there should be retinal vein, central retinal vein also. This was central retinal artery. Central retinal vein bring the blood out backward. Vein should drain. And this also passes through all those areas. Central retinal vein. Now you see, this is central retinal artery. Of course, blood is going in that direction. So it means central retinal artery and veins pass through subarachnoid space around the optic nerve. Am I really clear to everyone? Now, if there is, due to any reason, if intracranial pressure is high, you know, cranial cavity is not an expandable cavity. So if someone develops tumor or big hemorrhage, or someone develops a big infection in central nervous system or swelling, so pressure in the central, you know, due to that reason, when things swell up in inside the cranial cavity, pressure in the CSF will go down or up. So when pressure, CSF pressure will become high, then cerebrospinal fluid, which is around the optic nerve, that will have low pressure or high pressure? High pressure. Is that really clear? Now you imagine. Retinal artery is arterial system as compared to the venous system. Arterial system is high pressure system, low pressure system. High pressure. And as compared to arteries, venous system is low pressure. Pressure in the arteries is high and pressure in the veins is low. Now you imagine. If you have raised intracranial pressure, then CSF is under high pressure in the optic nerve. Retinal artery itself is a high pressure vessel. In spite of high CSF, it will still take the blood to the retina. But retinal vein, which is draining the blood back, is compressed by the high pressure of CSF. Is that right? Let me show you. This is the optic nerve, a dura mater. Here it is. What is this? Optic nerve. Artery cannot be compressed by high pressure, but vein can be compressed by right, and CSF pressure here is very high and raised intracranial pressure. So when vein is compressed, blood is going but cannot drain well. The pressure in the microcirculation of retina goes up and edema develops, and that leads to that funny papilledema. Edema accumulates especially around the optic disc margin. Am I really clear? And there's one more reason. Fluid of CSF, right, it also tracks through the nerve bundles and also goes over there. That also adds to the papilledema. But as a single cause, if you want to remember the single cause of mechanism of papilledema, you say papilledema develops in cases of raised intracranial pressure because that optic nerve has a sleeve of dura mater and subarachnoid space. So optic nerve is all the time bathing in CSF, and the central retinal arteries and central retinal vein pass through that space. When there's a high intracranial pressure, CSF pressure is high. High pressure of the CSF compresses the retinal vein, so drainage of retinal fluid is not well, and edema develops in the retina, which especially accumulate around the optic disc, and optic disc become edematous, and we say patient has papilledema. So it's so easy that you are going to do lumbar puncture. You just do ophthalmoscopy and look at optic disc. If it is its margins are blurred, then please don't do lumbar puncture. Patient's life will also blur and your professional career may also blur. Is that clear?
That means that there's high pressure, right? In the CSF?
Yeah. Papilledema means there's high pressure in the CSF. Is that right? So two features of raised intracranial pressure I discussed. Number one was headache, number two papilledema. Third feature of raised intracranial pressure is projectile vomiting. Raised intracranial pressure, right? It disrupts the GIT regulating centers in medulla, and vagus nerve is disturbed. You know, vagus nerve is coming out of medulla. Do you know that? Okay, that's good. So what really happens when raised intracranial pressure is there, right? Brain is a little bit herniating downward, vagus nerve is disturbed, and you know, vagus nerve supplies the GIT and control the motility of the GIT, regulate. So when it is firing too much, patient may develop retropropulsions and a vomiting, which is projectile vomiting. What is meant by the projectile vomiting? No, projectile vomiting means Abdul is sitting here and I vomit beyond him. Is that right? That is projectile vomiting, and he will be spared. Don't be upset. Is that right? I mean, this type of vomiting is a characteristic in small children. Very small children have normal vomiting projectile. Only mama knows. Is that right? But when we become adult, our vomiting is really not that, thank God, not that projectile. Right? But in adult life, if you redevelop your projectile vomiting, maybe one of the reasons is raised intracranial pressure. Then another two more classic features of raised intracranial pressure are progressively rising blood pressure. Every hour you take the blood pressure of the patient, it keeps on going up, and progressively falling pulse rate. I will explain why. Patient has progressively rising blood pressure and progressively falling pulse rate. For example, if raised intracranial pressure is there, now pulse may be 60, and after a few hours it may be 50. Still after a few hours, if it may become 40. Why? Because vagus is again irritated. And vagus in cardiostimulant or cardio inhibitor? Inhibitor. So, when heart rate is reduced, of course, pulse will go down. And why blood pressure goes up? Because when there's high pressure in central nervous system, then do you think blood can easily enter into central nervous system? No. So blood flow to central nervous system reduces and ischemia develops. And ischemia of central nervous system produces immense sympathetic overflow, which constricts many vessels in the body, and your blood pressure goes up. That is an attempt of the vessels of the body to constrict and push the blood to ischemic brain. Is that right? But you want me to revise it. Okay, listen. Cranial cavity cannot be expanded. It's a fixed cavity. Due to any reason, if pressure in the cranial cavity becomes too much, do you think then blood which is going to central nervous system, blood flow will increase to CNS or decrease? When blood flow to CNS will decrease, central nervous system will develop ischemia. When central nervous system develops significant ischemia, it produces intense sympathetic overflow. Sympathetic fibers fire. And many vessels in the body constrict. Right? In a way, all the vessels are squeezing the blood towards the central nervous system. Right? So due to that reason, if you take blood pressure, that will be high. But due to oversympathetic stimulation, heart rate does not go up because vagal stimulation is very severe, which inhibits the heart rate, overrides the sympathetic stimulation to the heart rate. Sympathetic nervous system tries to stimulate the heart rate, but parasympathetic definitely inhibits. Is that right? So if you come across a patient who complains of some headache, which is especially present on lying down, you look at the optic disc and you find this papillary edema, projectile vomiting is there, and progressively blood pressure is going up and pulse rate is going down, you must suspect strongly that there is raised intracranial pressure, and don't plan lumbar puncture. Am I clear? Okay.